All right. Don't speed through Lee County or Coburn. I know from experience. Yeah. I know a really good realtor. Free advertisement, Dad. You're welcome. Did you have one, darling? Go ahead. There's a lot of suicide going around. That's a really big problem right now. It's the fourth one I know of. Well, go ahead, Glenda. Okay. Absolutely. Absolutely. You notice he said man. That's true. That's true. Go ahead. Okay. Okay. Charles? A lot of medical stuff going on. That's been almost every prayer request, medical. Okay. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I'm glad my wife's here. It's been a while since she's come to one of the night services. Right. There you go.
That's
good. Absolutely. Okay. Anything else? Okay. Absolutely. He's been. He did. Amen. All right. Okay. I can't remember all these, I'm going to be honest, but I know who can. All right, is that all? That's good. Thank the Lord. What was that? Good. But just pray that God will heal his ear and the home will be okay. In the name of Jesus. What hospital is he in? Is he in the hospital? You say he's in the hospital?
No.
Oh, I thought you said he was. Okay.
But he's home now.
Good. Amen. All right.
He said just to be prayed for.
Okay. Go ahead. Okay. Absolutely. All right. Charlie, you want to do the honors? All right. Youth choir, come up and sing. You need this moved, Sue? No? Okay.
Earlier, we came down Friday to practice, and we do that a lot, you know, between our Tuesday night service and then the Fridays that we get together, whether it's fellowship or practice or whatever it is we're doing. And
we'd had a great practice and stuff, and we just decided that we wanted to end our practice in prayer, so we went through the sanctuary praying, and it's always interesting. I'm sure as you heard the prayer request given in tonight, you hear requests that were given in by a person that you prayed for Friday night. I could name several that really stood out to me. And God just came. I mean, you could just feel his presence so strong here Friday night. I mean, it was just, I think we ended up being here probably an hour and a half past when we had intended to leave. And, you know, I was sitting down here on the steps, and it's just awesome to look around and see a group of young people on a Friday night with their hands raised and not caring about what anybody else is doing or what's going on, but just, it's just them and the Lord here. And you know, if we ever reach a place where we get back to where it's just us and him, we really could move a mountain. We really could. I mean, it was such a blessing. I couldn't do anything but cry just sitting there watching. It's such a blessing. We have such a good group of young people in this church, and we're blessed just to have that, you know, and to have a church that is open to them working and being involved. We are truly, truly blessed. I saw this evening where there had been several bombings in different countries of Christians, you know, on today. And I thought, you know, we are so blessed to be able to come in and freely worship and freely sing and freely read our Bibles and freely lift our hands. And, you know, we were, I won't mention the name, but one of the students in my Sunday school class, we were talking about reading our Bible. She said, "I just don't have the time." And it was really cute because most of us don't read our Bibles nowhere near as much as we should. And we have all these reasons why we don't. And to us, those reasons are true. But it's amazing that we don't do something that someone in another country will risk dying over And we can just pick it up and do it anytime we want to. We could read it in Walmart if we want, whatever we wanted to do. And we take something for granted that people are willing to die for. We are a very spoiled bunch. We really are. Very blessed and very spoiled at the same time. So, well, you guys pray with us tonight and sing with us. If you know the songs, let's just get in and worship and enjoy the service together tonight.
Wake up, I feel it, those fears are back again. Can't shake them, can't make them ever fade, ever end. Am I good enough? Do I measure up? Feels like a war I can't win. But I wasn't given the spirit of fear, I was given the power of love. Everything I've been fighting against, I'm gonna lift it up. I wanna be fearless. No holding back, no backing down. Fearless, because I believe you're with me now. Bring on the unknown, lead me and I'll go. Come set me free, God, I want to be fearless. I want to be. To be these mountains, these giants will fall at a single word. In your name, in your strength, I'm more than a conqueror. But I wasn't given the spirit of fear, I was given the power of love. Everything I've been fighting against, I'm gonna lift it up. I wanna be fearless. No holding back, no backing down. Fearless, because I believe you're with me now. Bring on the unknown, lead me and I'll go. Come set me free, God, I want to be fearless. I want to be fearless. I want to be, I won't be afraid. I won't be afraid. I'll call on your name, but I'll walk out in faith. I won't be afraid, I won't be afraid. I'll call on your name, and I'll walk out in faith. I won't be afraid, I won't be afraid. I'll call on your name, and I'll walk out in faith. I wanna be fearless, no holding back, no backing down. Fearless, because I believe you. Bring on the unknown, lead me and I'll go. Come set me free, God, I want to be fearless. I want to be fearless. I want to be.
I won't be afraid, I won't be afraid. I'll call on your name, I'll walk out in faith.
I wanna be fearless, no holding back, no backing down. Fearless, because I believe you're with me now. Bring on the unknown, lead me and I'll go. Come set me free, God, I want to be fearless. I want to be fearless. I want to be fearless.
Above all nature and all created things.
above all wisdom and all the way the man. You were here before the world began.
Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known. Above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began.
Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, you were here before the world began.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Redemption till where your blood was spilled, your ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost.
Lead me to the cross.
You were the Word at the beginning. we're hitting glory in creation. Now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal. Glory, yours is the name above all.
I'm glad to see it. Do what? Oh, you don't want me singing. That's a no. Mm-mm. Nathan got lucky. That's good singing. Good job. Everybody. You know, Daryl, you were right. You never realize how much talent is in the youth group, in his church. It's crazy. Definitely blessed. Definitely blessed. All right. Go ahead and let them keep them going. We'll keep going. We'll go ahead and do the offering. Brooke, Sydney, do y'all want to take up the offering for me? Brooke, yeah, you too. Oh, you got baby. Okay. McKenna, you want to help her? You and Sydney. She's preoccupied at the moment. All right. Bill, you want to pray over the offering? All right.
Will you all pray tonight as you're giving your offering? And I haven't sung this song since I was a little kid. I'm trying to go back, and they're doing modern stuff, and I'm going to try to go back, and that way we get a good balance. But I haven't sung this song in probably 25 years, I guess. So just pray that it'll, it could be interesting. As Jesus is walking the last mile of Calvary's hill, Peter had denied him, they cried crucify him, but it wasn't his father's will. As he hung there in silence, our faith in the balance, I think back and I realize, when he said, Father, forgive them, he cried it was finished, there were tears in my father's eyes. Great I am, and who
25 years, I thought that was pretty good.
My lungs ain't what they was 25 years ago.
I don't believe it. All right. Next, we're going to bring Aaron to bring the sermon. So let's give him a bless you.
Hey, God bless you.
Praise the Lord. A light is shining down on me. Uh-oh. How's everybody doing this evening? Good, good. That's right. Well, today is Palm Sunday. Today was exactly the last week that our Savior's been on earth. And he did very significant things this week. And we want to talk about that a little bit in remembrance of that. How many knows God always has a plan? That's it. God has a plan for your life. Even from the day you were born, before that he knew you. And so he's planned your life out and you're in his hands. And I believe God had a plan from the beginning. I believe that he knew exactly what he was doing even before he began. Tonight, before we get going, I like to say that my face will likely get red and I'm going to start talking fast because I'm going to be nervous. So if I do that, just holler at me and tell me to slow down, okay?
Slow down.
Let's start in Romans 5:17. I like to give a quick testimony right quick. I think it's very good to testify.
Yes.
I really honestly didn't testify very much until the last maybe 6 months or so, just because I didn't feel comfortable, which is an easy trap to fall into. But it's such a blessing, and I've realized that because, to express your faith in front of others really builds up your own faith. And I think that's been good for our whole group being able to do this. So I thank you all for being able to put up with us, if we'll put it that way. So, Romans chapter 5, we'll start at verse 17. It says, "For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered, that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord." Dear God, we thank you for this night, Lord. We thank you for all that you've given us, God. Thank you for allowing us to meet together, Lord. I pray you'll touch everything that's said and all the songs that are sung so that it can bless somebody. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So like I said, this is Passion Week, which is pretty much the cornerstone of the Christian belief. This is the week that our Savior came, and he died for us, and he rose again. I'd like to approach this kind of from a different angle, because you're likely to hear several terms through this week, like the Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb, things like that. So we're going to learn a little bit about history tonight, and we're going to kind of figure out exactly where that came from. So this begins with a man named Abraham. And God says, "Abraham, I've got good things planned for you. Come with me, and I'll take you to a totally different country where you have nobody, and I'm going to plant you there, and I'm going to make you very strong. I'm going to make you a father of many nations, and all the nations will be blessed through you." He says, "I'll make a covenant with you. Your descendants will be multiplied by the sand on the seashore. And you'll be greatly established." Abraham had a son named Isaac. Isaac had a son named Jacob. Now, Jacob was a very special man. He made several mistakes. His first mistake was marrying more than one woman. Okay? Hold on now. The women's mistake was marrying him. So, okay? But Jacob was a very special man. He had 12 kids, which is a lot. He had 13 kids, 12 kids and one daughter. Those 12 kids ended up becoming the tribe of the Israelites. Each one was a specific tribe. But the land where God brought Abraham and his family to, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that land was struck by famine. And so they had to do something. They had to get out of there. So a couple things happened, and they ended up in Egypt. There was plenty of grain down there because of what Jacob's son Joseph did for them. So they had plenty of grain, plenty of water, and they could go down there and live. So they established themselves, And they began living down there in peace with plenty. But 400 years passed, and in that time, Joseph and Jacob were totally forgotten. The Pharaoh that loved them were totally forgotten, and a new Pharaoh came to power. And that Pharaoh really didn't like the Israelites, because by that time, the Israelites were probably, I'm going to throw out a rough guess here, probably about 700,000, 800,000 men, not to mention women and children. So they were kind of taken over. So the Pharaoh said, we got to do something. We got to get them out of here. So he enslaved them. He made them do forced slave work. And he said, you know, if you have a male child, I believe it was, a male child was to be killed. That way the Israelites could slowly be weeded out. But one male child escaped that period of persecution. His name was Moses. Moses grew up to be a man that was strong in the Lord. He was chosen by God to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. But Pharaoh didn't like that. Pharaoh said, no, you guys can't leave. So God brought on the plagues on the Egyptians. Now there were several. He turned all their blood to water, for one. He sent gnats. He sent frogs. He put bulls on their skin. He made it totally dark for several days, which I'm going to imagine was terrifying. But his last plague was the Passover. And in that one night, God sent a death angel all over the land of Egypt. And they was to kill the firstborn son of every family. So I was wiped out, sadly. Unless the blood of a precious lamb, perfect lamb, was killed and put over the door frame. Yes. If that happened, the death angel wouldn't go into the house. The Passover, basically. After that, Pharaoh said, you know, because he had an oldest son, and that oldest son died, and he said, I'm done. Forget it. Take, you know, all your families. Take your cattle. Take gold, jewels, anything. Get out of Egypt. Okay? So they escaped Egypt, and they went through some other adventures, and God finally gave them the law. Now, the law was perfect. It was there to guide them, to protect them in their lives. But the law had many issues. It was hard to follow, and not many could do it. And beyond that, it was not designed for us. Hebrews 8:7 says, for if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. But the law still served several purposes for us. It showed God's high standards for his people. Psalms 19:7 says that the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. God's standards for his people is very high. He wants us to be separate from the world. He wants us to be better. He wants us to serve him and to live righteous lives in front of everybody else. But the law showed that no one could live up to those standards. Romans 3:20 says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. We couldn't live up to that law. All it did was show our faults in us, which made it very hard to follow. It showed that we can't attain righteousness on our own. Ephesians 2 says, for it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. And the last thing that the law did was it pointed to our Savior. Genesis 3 says, I will put enmity between you and the woman. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Now, this is one of the first places where a picture of Jesus was seen. You'll notice it doesn't say they will crush your head. It says he will crush your head. It was pointing to one person. After that, the next place that he was really described was Exodus 12. And if you guys would like to go there, I'm going to read a couple of verses from there, and we'll talk about some of the things that they mean. Like I said, Exodus 12 was one of the first places where we get a good description of Jesus, kind of what he would be doing when he got here, a little glimpse of who he would be. Exodus 12:1 says, and the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. When God enters your life, you're a new creature. You're a new creation. You are basically newborn. We come up here every Sunday and we celebrate our spiritual birthdays. When God gets a hold of us, we are new. Our past is forgotten. Our sins are wiped away. We are fresh and clean. Verse 3 says, speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house. So the lamb had to be with the family on the 10th day of what their first month would be. Now, if you didn't know, that 10th day lines perfectly up with what we consider Palm Sunday. So on Palm Sunday was the day that Jesus entered Jerusalem. So on the 10th day, the lamb was supposed to be with the family, and on the 10th day, Jesus was in Jerusalem. Verse 4 says, if the household be too little for the lamb, Let him and his neighbor next unto him take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I've got plenty enough of the lamb. So I'm supposed to take and I'm supposed to share with my neighbor if I've got too much.
Come on.
So, verse 5 says, your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. The lamb that was chosen had to be without blemish, 1 year old, in the prime of its life. Jesus came and never sinned. He lived a perfect life. Everything that he did was for a purpose and was to fulfill prophecy and was to be a guide to us. When Jesus came, he was 33 years old. When he died, was 33 years old in the prime of his life. Exodus 6 says, and he shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. That lines up perfectly with what we consider Good Friday, the 14th day of the month. So Jesus was in Jerusalem, and he stayed around that area until the Passover, just like they did in the law. Exodus 12:7 says, and they shall take the blood. I'm getting somewhere now. They shall take the blood, and if you've got a King James Version Bible, it says strike it. Not take your fancy little brush and scoop it on there. Strike it. Bam. On each side of the doorpost and on the framing above. Strike it on the two sides, wherein they shall eat it. They covered a door to keep their firstborn safe and to follow the will of God. We need to be covered in the blood of Jesus to keep our souls safe and to be with Christ, because if our souls are not covered in that blood, then we'll be in trouble, okay? Moving on down to verse 13. It says, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. Now, notice it says where you are, not where you've been, not where you were before, where you are now. You're a new creature. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you. So Jesus' blood covers us.
Yes.
It cleanses us and removes our sin. We cannot attain righteousness on our own. We have to have a Savior.
Yeah.
Not only did Jesus take our place, because if he did, we'd still be in the same boat. He gave us his place so that we can leave here and we can be with Jesus in heaven.
Yes.
So that's a little bit about the history of the Passover. So when you hear that this week, you'll kind of, you know, understand it a little bit. So we're going to come to you for an altar call. If anybody would like to pray, we'd like to welcome you, whoever's coming to music. If you're not saved, you need to have that blood on your life. That way, when Jesus comes for you, you'll be ready to go. So thank you.
What can
is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.